In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Please be seated. So today the title of my sermon is A Vocation of Hope. Remember last week it was a vocation of preparation, but this week, Vocation of Hope. And let's start again with another story from my Megan McKenna book. So once upon a time, a man was unjustly accused of terrible crimes. And because he had no recourse for a lawyer, he had no real money, he had no friends with influence, he was convicted of those crimes on trumped-up charges, betrayed by his business partners, and thrown into jail for a long jail sentence. There he was, surrounded by those four cold stone walls, completely lonely and isolated and despairing. He had no idea how he was going to deal with all of this, no idea how long he'd be there. He was bereft. But one day, the jailer brought a gift from a friend. Didn't say who it was, just brought this gift. And when he unwrapped it, he found it was a prayer rug. He did not want a prayer rug. He wanted food. He wanted a clean shirt. He wanted someone to come visit him. He wanted a gosh darn crowbar, but he did not want a prayer rug. What was this person thinking? He thought to himself. How could they not understand my real needs here? I don't need a prayer rug. He rolled it up and he put it in the corner of his cell. Well, a couple days went by, and he woke up one morning, and he looked at that prayer rug, and actually he started to cry. And he realized someone cared enough to give me something. And all of a sudden, that prayer rug looked really beautiful. And so he unrolled it, facing east, knelt to the ground, and he prayed. He prayed for freedom, he prayed for deliverance, he prayed for patience, he prayed for the person who gave him that rug, he prayed his heart out, and it became a rhythm in his life. He prayed in the morning when the sun was just rising, he prayed at noon when the sun was blaring into his cell, he prayed at dusk as the sun was going down. He prayed every day, over and over again. He didn't want to become embittered like his jailer and like the people who betrayed him. He prayed for freedom from all of those things. And he began to trace when he prayed the pattern of the rug with his eyes. And then he began to trace the pattern of the rug with his fingers. And at a certain point he realized that this was not the usual pattern. That this rug was not the usual prayer rug. And many days later, it dawned on him why. That rug was a diagram of the lock mechanism on his cell door. And in that moment, he began to realize the possibilities of the future. He began to believe that freedom was possible. So you can imagine I'm a little irritated by that story because it doesn't say if he ever got out of there or not. You know, I want to know the end. I want to know if he ever got freed. But the truth is that the minute he had hope, he was free. The minute he had hope, he could begin to think about the possibility of the future. He could begin to dream of the future. The true prophets that we hear in our readings today help us to dream of the possibilities of our future. The first was Baruch. Now, this is what we know about him. We know that he was the secretary or the scribe for the prophet Jeremiah. That when the prophet Jeremiah had his visions and had his prophesying, Baruch wrote them all down. What we also know is that he did not write this book because it was written way after he died. So whoever named it for him was honoring him. And what it said in our reading today was the promise of God's freedom for the exiles. He's writing to the exiles. And he says, God is working on your behalf. You can have hope because God is going to free you. And in that freedom, there will be no pain and no sorrow. There will be a level, easy path. God is working for you right now. Hope is possible. Freedom is possible. It's interesting to me that both this prophet and the writer of the Gospel of Luke turn to Isaiah, another prophet of freedom, and quotes Isaiah saying that freedom is coming. A new exodus is possible. You know, the first exodus was when they were freed from Egypt. But now a new exodus from wherever you are confined to, from whatever is holding you in oppression, is coming. Be ready. Pay attention. There is hope and joy on its way. In Luke, the person we hear that from is John the Baptist, our friend John the Baptist, who was a pretty popular guy in his day. You know, actually, there were a lot of baptizers at that time. But John was well known and well appreciated because of his message, as well as his integrity, but his message. It was a twofold message. The first part was, repent, turn your life around. And the second part was, be ready for what's coming. Be ready for what's coming. And if you think about it, it's a logical progression, right? So the first thing is you have to look at your own life. You have to look at your internal workings and make sure everything's okay. You know, if you run into a friend on the street that you have had a terrible argument or even a falling out with, and there's no reconciliation, there's not going to be any conversation, right? And it's the same with God. We've accumulated a lot of sins. And God is wanting to bless us and wanting to love us and only wanting us to love back. But if we aren't right with God, that conversation's probably not going to happen, right? We have to acknowledge our sins and realize that God, what God wants for us is for us to be happy and holy. Happy and holy. And God wants us to want that for ourselves as well. And so we look at our lives, we repent of the things that we need to let go, we turn our lives back around to face God, to say we're sorry for our sins and to be forgiven so that we can be ready. Because that's part two, right? Part two is to say, I know something's coming. And that's what John tells us. John tells us there will be freedom now. There will be someone coming now to free you from your oppression. There is something happening now. So get ready. Because you can have hope in what is to come. Your freedom. Are you ready? Because it's coming. And that allows us to hope, right? Once we believe that something wonderful is on its way, we can be hopeful. And that is part of our vocation. That is one of the things that we have been given gifts and talents to offer, is to live out our vocation of hopefulness. So first we have to believe it, right? We have to believe that hope is possible. We have to be able to proclaim it, to speak that hope, and then we have to live it. A couple years ago, we asked kids in the Youngstown Public Schools to write essays about hope. And over again, it wasn't about the theory. It was about how you live it. That's what they wanted to do, and that's what they wanted to see. We believe it. We proclaim it. We are a sign of it. We live it out. We make it possible. We prepare the way of the Lord. So this week I was at Williamson Elementary School twice. On Thursday we handed out those 1,000 books that you donated. And there are a couple of people here who were a part of that. So ask them their story because it was remarkable. The looks on those kids' faces were remarkable. And then the next day, Friday, I was there for the Student of the Month lunch, recognizing academic achievement. Brought them a beautiful lunch for Christmas of chicken and mash and mac and cheese and green beans and cookies, and oh, we had a great time. And each time I looked in the faces of those children, and you could see the ones who had hope and the ones who did not. There were kids who did not have hope in their eyes, and there were kids who did, who believed they had a future, who believed that something good was coming. I'm proud we were a little part of that, but we can't just be a little part of that. We have to all work together to help those kids and our world, our troubled, messed up world, to know that there is a possibility of hope, and that for some people and for whole groups of people, maybe they can't feel that right now. But we know it, we proclaim it, and we live it. Because if we aren't working for hope, then we are not preparing the way. That's part of our vocation, is to work for hope, to prepare the way for the good things that we know are coming. So this week I want you to pray about that. I want you to pray about whether you believe it, whether you proclaim it, and how you live it. Amen.